And the Lord said to me that this month, declare to my people that I want to establish my presence in them. So this month is the dominion of God's presence. The dominion of God's presence, which I want to explain to you. We're going to take our key scripture from John chapter 15. The book of John chapter 15 is giving us the secret to the establishment of God's dominion in our lives. I read from verses 1. It says here, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Now Jesus is giving us some scriptural fruits by using a vine to explain it so that you can understand what he's talking about. He said, every branch in me that does not bear fruit, take note of that fruit, it's not fruits, it's fruits. I'm going to get to that in a few moments from now. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. You are already clean because of the word which I've spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As a branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. Verses 5. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. For without me you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he's cast out as a branch and is withered. And they gather them and throw them into the fire and they are burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire and it will be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, so you will be my disciples. Now let's look at the scripture that we've read now. You can clearly see there that Christ is trying to explain some things to us by saying that it is possible for you to be a branch and still not bear fruit. Now, and he says that if you are a branch in me, which means you can be born again, you can be a branch and don't bear fruit. So he said, if you are a branch in me and you do not bear fruit, my Father cuts you off. Is someone listening to me? Now, what that is saying to us is, in other words, it's saying is, if a branch of a tree is not bearing fruit, what it means is, it means that that branch is not absorbing from the sap that is in the tree. It means that that branch is not a true representation of the tree, because there is a blockage in the flow of fluid that would make the branch produce the fruit that it's supposed to produce. So because it is not representing the tree very well, you've got to trim it off. And that is what the Bible is saying here, that God is saying, if you call yourself a Christian, if you come to church, if you're a worker in the church, a leader in the church, or a minister of God, and your life is not representing the kingdom of God, the Father will do what? Cuts you off. Because your life must represent the kingdom. And then he went further on to speak. He said, if you abide in me and you bear fruit, he said, my father will not come and prunes you. You know, pruning is a special skill. If you're a horticulturalist, it's a special skill. It's not everybody that can prune a garden. So God comes and he does the pruning, which is a process. Now, the pruning is done for you to grow healthier. The pruning is done for you to get much more fruit. The pruning is done to make you look beautiful. The pruning is done to make sure that you are not having an abnormal growth. So which is what the Father does. So it doesn't stop because you bear fruit. God doesn't stop there with you. He keeps doing more work with you so that you can bear much more fruit. Now we're going to go to that in a few moments. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Somebody praise the Lord. So it is one thing to abide in Christ and another for Christ to abide in you. Now, because he said, if you abide in me and I abide in you. So it is one thing for you to abide in Christ. A lot of people abide in Christ. We come to church. We attend prayer meetings. We carry our Bible. But actually, Christ is not really living in us. And you can't, there's nothing you can do about that. If Christ is not living in you, you will be struggling. You'll find yourself doing certain things which you shouldn't be doing. Is someone listening to me? You'll find yourself acting in a way which you shouldn't be acting. Now you abide, you know you believe in Jesus. You've accepted him as your Lord. You come to church. You know what the Bible says. But because there is no life that would help you to live the kind of life God wants you to live, you begin to struggle. Now, for you to be able to live the life which God wants you to live, then there must be a connection between the branch and the vine itself, which means there must be a flow. Praise God. Now, this means that for this to happen, you've got to get to a point, which is what the Bible says when it says that they that are led by the Spirit of God are called the sons of God. Because he says to be carnally minded is dead. So for you to get to the point where you're being led by the Spirit of God, it means that Christ is now taking dominion of your thoughts, he's taking dominion of your decision, he's taking dominion of everything about you. You've allowed him so much into your life that you no longer live for yourself, live for him. That's where we're going. Praise God. So before you can experience the dominion of his presence, he will take you through the process. The process of you having that spiritual hunger for spiritual growth. I want to grow. I am tired of my level. I don't want to sin anymore. I don't want to be like this anymore. I need a change. I don't want to talk like this anymore. I don't want to behave like this anymore. I need a change. Now there must be a spiritual hunger for a change in your life before that something must happen. Spiritual hunger. So now he says, he takes you through that pruning process. But if you're a Christian and you're so used to sin, you say everybody's doing it. Oh, I don't care. It doesn't matter. I'll ask God for forgiveness. I'll do this. I'll do that. You keep on doing it. You're not feeling remorse because you've been born again for 30 years. It doesn't matter. You know everything in the Word of God. You know the hardest people to change is people that feel they know the Word. They know the Word, but the Word is not producing any change in their life. Before you finish quoting the scripture, they will finish it for you. They will even explain it to you. But what they are explaining is not evident in their own life. So you need to have that understanding. Now, this is what he's saying. So you are abiding in him, but he is not abiding in you. It's not going to get what I'm talking about. If you are shouting, big amen.
Amen.
So God is interested in his children growing healthily. God is interested in what you are becoming every day. Because he has a picture, he has a plan. You must conform to the image of his son. And the only way you can conform to the image of Jesus Christ, it means that you must allow something from him to come to you, which comes through his word. Now let's read on verses 3. It said, you are already cleansed. He said, you are already cleansed. Because of the word I've spoken to you. Which means you don't have an excuse. The word which God has spoken to you has already cleansed you. It has already removed every contamination. So you don't have any reason not to bear fruit. You don't have any reason not to grow healthily. So he takes care of that. So now, which means that if you're a child of God and you're not bearing fruit, it could be there could be one disease, spiritual disease, or one thing that is stopping it. What you need to do to get rid of it before God gets rid of you is to allow the word of God to produce that cleansing in you. You allow the word to produce that cleansing in you. Because you know that when it thinks that when something is cleansed, it's appealing to the eyes. Nobody wants to use a dirty cup. Nobody wants to use a dirty spoon. But when something is cleansed, you know, neat and pure, you want to use it. You are dear to it. That's exactly how it is. So the word of God performs the operation of purifying you. That's what Jesus said to his disciples here. But then it doesn't stop there. It doesn't stop there. You must keep on growing. Now, verses 4 says, abide in me, and I in you. Abide in me, and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, unless it abides in the branch, neither can you unless you abide in me. Now, he's saying here that you cannot attain a holy life of your own strength. God knows that because you are in the flesh, because you have the Adamic nature in you, you can't attain a holy life of your own ability. He said, so the secret to you living that life that will make whatsoever you desire to come to pass, because you know that some of you desire something. If God is to honor everybody's desire, the world will be in danger. Because some people have all kinds of terrible desires. Somebody might be sitting beside you, is wishing that you should die, or something terrible should happen to you. So that is why God doesn't honor every desire. Every desire that has its root in the flesh cannot come to pass. Every desire that will not help you fulfill purpose, it might be good in your own eyes now, but God knows it's not good for the kingdom, he won't answer it. But he says, when you begin to grow in the Lord, when you begin to abide in him, you will get to a point where you'll be so connected with him that your desires will be his own desire. Is someone listening to me? Somebody praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Now let's look at what the Bible says. It says, if you abide in me and I abide in you, you bear much fruit. Much fruit. Not fruits, fruit. Now, which means that in the kingdom of God, there are levels in the quantity and quality of the fruit you bear. There are levels. It's talking about one fruit, but it keeps changing. The Bible says, beholding his face like a mirror, we are moved from one glory to another level of glory. Which means that there is a level God wants you to bear much fruit. Now, the fruit the Bible is talking about here is the fruit of the Spirit. So Jesus is teaching his disciples that the fruit of the Spirit is the most important thing. Now, when the disciples came back after he gave them power, they went to cast out devils, they cast out demons, they did all sorts of miracles, and they came back. They were rejoicing in the book of Luke, chapter 10. How is it, demons bowed down to us? Demons did it. Jesus said, No. Don't rejoice because all those things have happened. Rejoice because your name is written in the book of life. So those people that have their name written in the book of life are the people that are connected, that is drinking from the Lord himself. Those are the people. Because those people will never wither. Those people will always bear fruit. The Bible says in Galatians chapter 5 verse 22, it says, for the fruit of the Spirit is love. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Now, these are levels. The fruit of the Spirit is love. Now, let's look at the word love. Fruit of the Spirit is love. Do you love your brother? Do you love your sister? Do you love your neighbor? How far are you willing to go for your brother and your sister? Are you self-centered? Everything is just about yourself. If Jesus came and he didn't live his own life, he lived for people. He died for people. He died at the prime of his age, at 33 years old. He wasn't in any relationship. He didn't get married. He didn't go and look for a job. He didn't do all those things just because of you. He gave his life, he sacrificed his life so that he can become a better person. And that is an example of love. What are you willing to sacrifice? You see, let me tell you something. There'll be surprises when we get to heaven, because you need to understand what Jesus is saying here. Love is the key thing. Love is the foundation of the fruit of the Spirit. God is love. He said, if you abide in me, God will keep teaching you. He said, the more you walk with the Holy Spirit, the more the Holy Spirit will be correcting your thoughts, your motive, what you are doing. The more you think that you've attained, the more you are just starting. Because he keeps correcting everything you're about to do. He keeps telling, this is how you can get better. So you keep becoming, you keep changing from one level of glory to another level of glory. Can somebody shout a big amen?
Amen.
So you need the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is what he's talking about. But the secret of bearing that fruit, I don't know why. I find it hard to forgive people. The reason is because he's not abiding in you. Oh, I don't know, I can't stop talking. I find myself saying things I don't want to say. He's not abiding yet in you. Oh, I get angry. And when I get angry, I have all kinds of outbursts. I can't help myself. He's not abiding. You are abiding in him, but he's not abiding in you. Oh, I find myself drawn to a lot of worldly things. A lot of things, this. It's because you are abiding. Until he abides in you, you cannot bear the fruit of the Spirit. You will find it hard to love your neighbor. You will find it hard not to get angry. You will find it hard to do the things of the Spirit because he's not abiding in you. So that's why it says on Christians, when you can easily tell Christians that God is not abiding, or maybe they have a little of God in them. They are in God. When they come to church, they praise, they are excited, the activities or everything, they are there. They are there. But the life of God is not in them. The Bible says, having the form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, it shows in the nature you are displaying. In the nature you are displaying. Jesus never told a lie. So if we're going to become like him, should we be lying? Should we be comfortable lying? Should we be comfortable gossiping? Should we be comfortable slandering? Should we be, if you are comfortable with all those things and you sit on the church and you don't see anything wrong in it, he's not abiding in you. Very soon, the Father will come and chop you off. So he's saying in this month of February, there must be the dominion of my presence in you, because that is the secret. As a man begins to increase the level of God's presence in him, the more you'll be able to take dominion on the surface of the earth. He needs to be in you. I can't help it. I'm just too arrogant. I don't like people talking to me in that way. But they call Jesus Beelzebub. Did he get annoyed? Did he throw a stone at somebody? They said all sorts of things about him, called him all kinds of names. Did he get out of it? Did he misbehave? No. Did he lose his identity? No. He knew who he was. So if you want to be like Jesus, then you've got to give him access. Let him get into you. You're doing a great job by being in him, but you need to do a greater job by letting him come inside you and change you. And the secret is in the Word. In the Word. A lot of people have this kind of, the rate by which you are absorbing nutrients and minerals and the sap, the rate at which you absorb will determine how much fruit you bear, the rate. If the rate is slow, you might not be able to meet up with bearing the fruit. Now, the rate of how much you absorb the Word of God You hear the word every time, but how much is actually getting into you will determine the rate of change that will take place in your life. The rate by which you are absorbing the things of the kingdom, the things of Jesus. The more you are absorbing it into yourself, the more you'll be changed. Because you cannot change yourself. Jesus said, you can do nothing without me. But when you give him access to you, then he will come and do what? He will come and do wonders. God, we have somebody here today. Amen. Somebody shout a big hallelujah. So to bear much fruit, you need both. Both of them. You need to be in him by coming to church, by praying, by fasting, by doing all that. You also need to allow him to be in you by giving attention to what you are hearing, by examining your own life and say, Lord, am I at peace with you? What I'm doing, is it pleasing to you? Can you help me? By allowing the word, by meditating on his word, by learning on his word and actually practicing his word, and say, if the word of God says this, it may be hard, I am going to follow it. It is when you get to that point that you begin to abide with him. Now, you see, let me say something. Let's just quickly go to Galatians. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. Paul was speaking here. Paul got to a point because you have to get to that point where Christ must abide in you. When he abides in you, you become a broken vessel. If you are still full of yourself, full of your own ways, he's not yet abiding in you. But when he's abiding in you, you be careful of what you say. You have a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart, I will not despise, says the Lord. So you're just there. People will come around you, they will see that there is something different about you. It's not about you, it's about his kingdom. It's about him. Now that's what Paul is saying in Galatians 2 verse 20. He said, I've been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live. Now that is what Jesus is saying. Let me abide in you. I've been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. Now he's taking dominion of me now. He's using my body as he wants because he's now living in me. No longer me. I'm not living to fulfill my own self. I'm now living to fulfill what he wants me to fulfill. He said, and the life I now live in the flesh. He said, the life I now live in this body, in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loves me and gave himself for me. Hi viewers, I hope you have been blessed with this message. I believe that the message you've heard today is going to change your life and turn it around. God is about to do an amazing thing in your life. You are not going to be the same anymore. So I'm just going to take this time to pray for you. If you're sick in your body, wherever you are, just lay your right hand upon that part of your body that you're sick. And if you're believing God for any business breakthrough or financial breakthrough, or for anything you want God to do, stretch your hands towards the TV right now as I pray. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, let the sick be healed. According to your word that says, by the stripes of Jesus we are healed, I declare that sickness get out of their bodies. I speak over their finances to receive breakthroughs. I speak over their business, over their homes. I declare peace and prosperity. In the name of Jesus, receive your miracle right now. It is done in Jesus' name. Now, if you want to give your life to Jesus Christ, I just wanted to place a right hand upon your chest and say this after me. Say, Lord Jesus, I surrender myself to you. Forgive me my sins. Write my name in the book of life. I accept you and I receive you as my personal Lord and Savior. Thank you for saving me. In Jesus' name. Now you are saved. You are now born again. Please feel free to contact us if you need materials, if you need help, you know, regarding your spiritual growth. Contact us. Call us on the number
that is showing on the screen. You can write me personally. The email is showing there. The address is showing as well. Write me. I'd like to hear from you. For as many that call today, right now, we will send you a copy of today's CD. If you're in Manchester or around Manchester, please feel free to worship with us every Sunday at Unit 23, Lord Byron Square, Salford, Manchester. Showing on the screen, we meet every Sunday from 9:30 to 11 o'clock, first service. We have our Sunday school from 11 to 11:30. And then we have second service from 11:30 to 1. I promise you, you will be blessed beyond comprehension. Make time to fellowship with us. And then every Friday, we meet, you know, we meet every Friday, except the last Friday where we have our all nights between 7 to 9 p.m. is power-packed services during the week. God bless you. Feel free to contact us on the information. And if the Lord lays it in your heart to support this TV ministry, you could drop a donation. If you're writing a check, you can write it to Jesus Foundation Family International. Send a check to us or send a donation, the circle and the account number. If you want to pay by card, you can phone us up. We'll take your details and process that. The Lord bless you tremendously in Jesus' name. See you again next week. God bless you.